to Brother and Sister Arnold. Now, she turned none of your business a few months ago, and we honored her here at church. So, but we'll reach back and say some things about Sister Arnold as well. But this Monday, as I've already mentioned, is Brother Arnold's 75th birthday, and we are very thankful that God has blessed him with good health. And he's had a little bumps in the road, but for the most part, he is healthy and going strong, and we appreciate that. Amen. And he'll be preaching for us here at home in a couple of weeks, and we're excited about that. But at this time, I'm going to ask Brother Phil Holly to come and make some comments.
It's a great honor for me to be able to stand up here and recognize my and pray tribute to my wonderful friend, Brother Arnold, who means so much to me over the years. And his scripture, one that always sticks in my mind, and he preaches so often, is one that says, "Iron sharpeneth iron," and that, you know, always has kind of stuck with me, but really didn't know what it meant. So I looked it up and read it, and that's only part of the scripture on it. There's another part to it that says, "So a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friends." And so I got to thinking, well, how did that apply to Brother Arnold and his life, and how's it worked out? And the example came to my mind real quick. God puts iron people in iron people's ways so they can make them better. And I got to thinking about Sister Arnold, and everybody knows how strong she is. You wouldn't know that by just looking, just like you couldn't tell how strong iron is by just looking at it, but you can tell through a test. And one time, Brother Arnold was talking to me on the phone at dinner time. They were in the kitchen, evidently, and we were discussing something on the phone, and Sister Arnold was making, I think, meatballs for supper. And while I was talking to Brother Arnold, he abruptly stopped talking to me, and he turned and said some corrective words to Sister Arnold about something. I didn't hear all of it because he kind of muffled it. And then immediately he come back and starts talking to me. And when he starts talking to me, I hear this splat, and then this silence, and then this bursting out laughing. And I'm thinking, what in the world is going on here, you know, and stuff like this. And so he finally stopped laughing long enough. And I said, "What's happened with Arnold?" He said, "I just got hit in the head with a meatball." The Iron Lady had told him, "You might talk to other people like that, but you're not talking to me." So, in the case of this iron woman, it only took a little meatball to sharpen the countenance of this man. And he didn't seem very animated about it. So I got a new understanding of the scripture that was there. One other time, we went to Alaska a dozen times or so, and it was just, every so often my mind just goes back to the wonderful times that we had there. And one time in particular, Steve Dia, Doc D was there, Janice and I, and it was like 2 o'clock in the morning, and we was out fishing on the Crooked Creek, and brother, we had a campfire all set up, and Brother Arnold said he was gonna sit there by the campfire. So Janice and Stevie and I, we walked down and caught some fish, and when we come back catching fish, Brother Arnold jumped up and he goes, oh my gosh, you missed it. And I said, "You know what?" He says, a camel just walked right through here. And we go, "A camel in Alaska?" And Stevie says, "Was it a one humper or a two humper?" And so finally we discovered that what he thought was a camel was a moose that had just happened to walk by. So I forgot that you can't take Brooklynese up in Alaska. It made me think about how we started getting going to Alaska and why that happened. And there's one thing that I've always admired about Brother Arnold is his faithfulness and his work ethic that he has towards this church and towards the people of this church. And as many of you know, he never took vacations. He just would not do it. And so one time in 1996, my son Craig was graduating from high school, and so I was telling him I was going to take him to Alaska to graduate, you know, for celebrate. And so I said, "Why don't you come to go with us?" "Oh no, I couldn't do that." He said, "Well, there is this guy up there that wants me to preach." and stuff. And I said, and that's just very typical, Brother Arnold. He was going to have a working vacation, so he figured it out, and we hadn't determined where we're going to go, so he called Brother Churchill, the pastor there, and so I said, is there fishing there? And he said, oh, there's great fishing. So through Brother Arnold's connection, we decided we'd go up and fish, and he took Dan with it. So it was a father-daughter and father-son trip, and so we fished for a while, and Brother Arnold fished for men, you know, for a while. And I was thinking about the impact of that, how something just as minor as that, and thinking about the number of years and wonderful times that we had, and the impact that it has had, you know, on my life to be able to spend that time, quality of time with them. And then I got to thinking what has happened and how the connection of the two churches from Alaska to here and the results from it. And I personally have benefited because through us being up there, getting connected with the church, my son, you know, married the monk, Montgomery girl, and as a result of that, I have a grandson that came out of that. And I got to thinking about the heritage that came as a result of that and the beauty of that. And as some of you might not know, but Ramona's parents were missionaries when Alaska was considered a foreign country, and it started a great deal of work through that up there. And so the heritage that has been passed down from that and the impact of the Montgomery family and the Montgomerys and the Hollies can share this wonderful grandson. And I attribute that directly to the fact this man wanted to go preach and not just fish. And it made that connection that I'll be benefactor of that for many, many years to come. And I'm going to prophesy and I'm going to say there's going to be great things come out of Bodie Holly as a result of the heritage from the Montgomery family and from the Hollies. Thank you, brother.
While in St. Louis a few weeks ago for NAYC and waiting to check into our hotel, I started casually talking with another woman in UPC who was sitting on the couch in the lobby. The small talk eventually led to me asking her where she was from and vice versa. When I said, I'm from Gainesville, Florida, from Brother Jimmy Tony and from Brother Jeff Arnold's church. Please don't take this the wrong way, Brother Tony. But when she heard Brother Arnold's name, she jumped off the couch and said, did you just say Brother Jeff Arnold? The Brother Jeff Arnold? And for a split second, I wasn't sure if I was going to say yes or no. But when I said yes, her eyes grew big, her face lit up, her arm was extended for a handshake, and she said, he's my favorite preacher in the whole wide world. Her daughter was standing beside her, same exact reaction. After she learned my name, I was then introduced as, this is Sister Goodson. She goes to Brother Arnold's church. She called every young person in her group over to meet me. They were each excited to shake my hand and meet me as she was. Her husband later came in, same reaction. She immediately was like, honey, this is Sister Goodson. She goes to Brother Arnold's church. I felt like a politician. I was shaking so many people's hands. If her long-lost relatives were there, I think she would have introduced me to them as well. It was definitely the closest I've ever been or will ever be to being a celebrity. In the past several years, Mariah has enjoyed having the opportunity to take pictures of some of your antique cars. For those who don't know, he's an antique car buff. I looked up what it takes to restore an old classic, and this is what I read. Restoring a classic car requires time, dedication, patience, and money. One of the most important parts of restoration is the engine, because it is the heart of the car. That's the way it was described. Without the engine running, the rest of the restoration can wait, because what good is a restored car that can't run? When working on the body of the automobile, it can be time-consuming, messy, and frustrating. Unfortunately, there's no shortcut or easy way out of doing quality restoration work. And so I parallel this with your ministry. You're truly one of the greatest preachers on the grace, mercy, and restoring power of Jesus. Amen. You've taken much time to teach us and work on our hearts. Without a right heart, nothing else really matters. Through all the years with us, you've remained dedicated to the kingdom and to this church assembly. Lord only knows how much money you've spent on us, a lot of money. We have been time-consuming, messy, and frustrating. We were not always easy to work on. I won't deal too much with the patience part, but I know that we were on your last nerve many times. The times you needed to use extra elbow grease and pressure, we know that you were just trying to get us to shine that much greater for His kingdom. None of us would be here in this building tonight without you. Thank you for not sending us back to the junkyard, even though you might have thought about doing that a few times. When Mariah was little, I found a 3x5 card when cleaning up, and she had drawn angels and clouds on one side, and as I turned it over, she had written Mariah's ticket to heaven on it. And I thought that was pretty funny. If it was only that easy, here's my ticket to get in. My kids had a lot to learn from you, and teach them you have. I appreciate all the times that you visited my dad when he was sick in hospice care, and after he passed away, I found a journal entry he had written where he would wake up at 2 a.m. in the morning and pray for preachers specifically to speak the word of God with boldness and not be influenced by opinion or people. Thank you for all the times you've spoken into my life and into the lives of my children. I apologize for any sleepless nights we may have caused you, but I know that in you, my dad's prayers were answered. You've definitely been a shepherd and now a bishop that my family needed. And I found this, well, I've had it. I don't know if you remember this, Og Mandino, the 12th angel. Oh, yeah. It was one of the first books you ever gave us to have your autograph, so it may be worth something. I don't usually cry, but this book was one that had me crying. It's the story of a little boy who, unknowns to his baseball coach, had a brain tumor. The petite boy was clumsy and couldn't walk very well. Timothy Noble was the last kid to be selected on the team called the Angels, only because no one else would choose him. He couldn't hit the ball. Yet Timothy had two mottos in life. The first one was, day by day, in every way, I'm getting better and better. And his second motto was, never give up, never give up, never give up. And I think you included this in the sermon one time. But his coach was faithful to meet with him after every practice to help him one-on-one in the privacy without the other kids being around to laugh at him. In the end, the team went on to play in the championships, and it was the only game that Timothy Noble ever hit a ball and made it to base. He ended up bringing in the winning run when he crossed the home plate. Without a coach consistently working with him, Timothy would have never known what making it home felt like. I thank you, Brother Arnold, for your consistency in showing up to practice and staying late for all of us who needed extra batting practice. Your ultimate goal has always been that we make it home. You never gave up on us. I'm so thankful for the day you were born, and I'm even more grateful for the day that you were reborn. We love you. I wish you a happy birthday with no layovers this year and no lost luggage.
Tribute to Brother Arnold. First of all, I'd like to talk a little about gratitude. I'm grateful for all the men of God who have spoken into my life. There have been many, and here's just a few. You gentlemen may recognize a few. Brother Kenneth W. French, apostle to Alaska. I came into the church under his ministry. His wonderful wife, Sister Louise French, who loved me into the church, basically. Brother C. Haskell Yaden, missions director back in that day and time, was greatly impressed by his preaching. Brother J.T. Pugh preached in Alaska when I was just a kid, and I was really not just impressed, but I was very impacted. Brother Norman Rutson, he helped me to understand why God wouldn't heal my leg. Brother Johnny Clement, president of CBC, Conference Bible College, greatly spoke into my life. And the many ministers that came by CBC when we were there, Brother C.M. Becton, Brother Pugh, Brother Nathaniel Urshan, and I couldn't think of more, but there were definitely many more. And they've all, I'm built upon what all those men put into my life.
Brother Winfred Toole, he was Ramona and I's pastor at First Church Milwaukee in Portland, Oregon, while we were in CBC, after our Brother Rome had retired or resigned. And Brother Winfred Toole married us. Of course, Ramona's dad, Bill Crumpacker, my father-in-law, pastor in Kenai, greatly impacted me. I think I made a great impact on him. He used to tell his ministry friends that I dated his refrigerator and married his daughter. He loved me though. Well, I know my mother-in-law loved me anyway. Never in my life did I think we'd live in Florida. Up until probably about 1998, I didn't even know where Gainesville was. To have had Brother Jeff Arnold as my pastor has been one of God's special blessings and honors. His depth is amazing. His preaching is world class. Nothing that comes up in a service trips him up. No spirit raising its head in a service surpasses his apostolic acumen. His preaching has impacted the church locally, nationally, and worldwide. I'd like to talk for a moment about friendship. Phil said a little bit about iron sharpeneth iron, so that the countenance of a man. I was going to read that scripture, but he already did. I was told when we moved here not to expect Brother Arnold to ever be my friend or my chum. Well, that's okay. I thought, you know, that's okay. I, like the centurion in scripture, know where the lines of authority are. I understand the concepts of familiarity as a layperson and fraternization around the ministry. I was not expecting that kind of friendship. My goal was to become a part of the foundation or the floor. And floors are much more likely to become friends with souls than they are others, if you can catch my drift. But it turns out, that our conversion stories are quite similar. We both received the Holy Ghost in around 1967. Yes, sir. Our lives before the church are similar. We both came out of an alcoholic home. We both tried to do good and please God before receiving the Holy Ghost, but just could not. The Holy Ghost radically changed us both. Both of us had friends and family who dropped us like a hot rock and thought we were in a cult or something. Both of us were pretty savagely treated because of our stand for Jesus Christ at that day and time. It also turns out we both like old cars, and we've had great times going to events together. We've talked, we've laughed, we've cried, we've shared our testimonies. The Bible says in Proverbs 18:24, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Friendship is very important to me, and it would take up too much time to try to peel the onion, if I can say it like that, as to why friendship is so important to me, but it certainly is. Didn't make friends easily as a child. I think I was too ornery. Managed to make a lot of people not trust me when I was a kid, and made me value trust because I couldn't get it when I was young. But when I got the Holy Ghost, God gave me the ability to start acting right, and I started gaining people's trust and started making friends. And friendship means a lot, a very lot to me. Safe to be around. One of the highest compliments Brother Arnold ever paid me was when we were riding together in my car, going to or from some car event, talking, he simply made a remark that he was safe with me. It startled me a little bit, and I quickly said, "Of course you're safe with me." And then I pondered for a moment, why would he say that? Why wouldn't he be safe with me? Then it dawned on me, many preachers, especially those of Brother Arnold's caliber, live in a minefield. They have to be so careful. What a compliment I feel that was. To me, being a friend and being trustworthy is a mark of personal integrity. Everybody, especially the man of God in your life, needs his King's X. When we were kids, we used to play a game, and there was always a place you could go, and they couldn't tag you. They couldn't get you. You could get on King's X. And I had to say that because there's probably folks in the crowd here that don't know what that means, but we do. They need their King's X. They need a safe place. They need a safe person that doesn't need to know everything. Don't want to know everything. I just want to be there. I want to be part of the foundation. Like they said of Peter, seemeth to be a pillar. Well, when you hear the word pillar, you think of some big elaborate column. That's not what comes to my mind. In Alaska, they have what they call sonotubes, and if you can't just put a house on some blocks or on some wooden piers, it's not going to last very long because the earth moves so much. A pillar is something that you put in the ground first that you're going to put your foundation on. And I'm happy and willing to be that. And that's one of my great goals in life. Brother Arnold, thank you for your trust. Thank you for your Christ-like, honorable friendship. Happy birthday. My family loves and appreciates you very, very much. And on behalf of Pentecostals Gainesville, I ask it.
What an honor it is to be here this evening with this wonderful congregation and with two friends that my wife and I hold very, very close to our heart. At a time when we needed them the most, they made themselves available, and they will never, ever know the value of what that has meant to us. There is a somewhat popular phrase that simply says, behind every great man, there is a great woman. While I think I know the thought process behind that phrase, perhaps a purer way of stating that would be to say that beside every great man, there is a great woman. After all, it was from Adam's side that woman was created. With this in mind, when I think of Sister Patty Arnold, she is surely a great woman that has faithfully stood behind and beside her husband all of these years. In a world where lips can very quickly get loose and where compliments can be plentiful but lack depth and sometimes sadly lack truth, I think it's important for you to know something, Sister Arnold, that the words we share this evening are true, and they are pure, and ultimately they will be inadequate to convey how we truly feel. In truth, your life speaks for itself. There's no real accurate way to measure the impact that you have had on those around you. You're not loud. You don't have the desire, any desire whatsoever, to be the center of attention. You prefer to stand and to work in the shadows of others. Yet it's from those shadows that you have left a forever mark on those who have had the privilege to know you. That forever mark is adequately described by Job. In Job 37:7, where Job simply says, he sealeth up the hand of every man that all men may know his works. And so whether we want to or not, we leave a little bit of ourselves behind on everything and on everyone that we touch. So your quiet demeanor and your steady steps have served to be a firm foundation on which to grow a great church and a fruitful ministry. God sealed your hands that everyone may know your work. It's not gone unnoticed down here, and it surely won't go unrewarded on heaven's sweet shore. In the 21st century of constant change, there is something to be said about things that remain the same all through time. From the very first moment that we met until this evening, Sister Arnold, you have been that constant. Through the years, you haven't had to say anything to bring a sense of security. It's just been your very presence that has brought balance to the Pentecostals of Gainesville and to the families who have had the privilege to interact and be a part of your life. In Psalms 26:12, David said, my foot standeth in an even place. And you have a presence that creates, not only does it create, but it maintains an atmosphere of that even place. What a challenge it would be to try to attempt this evening or at any point to place a true value on something like that. You bring a great, great gift to the table. You have been that certain something that brings peace to a situation. I call that a ministry of presence. You don't have to really say a lot. You don't have to really even do a lot. Yeah. It's just being there that brings calm to a situation that could be otherwise. The ministry of presence is a priceless gift, and we applaud you for that this evening.
All right.
Should we be able to roll back time, we would be able to clearly see how that your steps have surely been ordered of the Lord. God had his hand on you from the very beginning. It was your sense of appreciating the real power of God's word that led you and your husband to a United Pentecostal church right here in Florida. As a young girl, you experienced something genuine while attending Pastor Fred Kinsey's church in Toledo, Ohio. Something unique happened to you when you were baptized in Jesus' name that day. It was just an ordinary day for them, but it was an extraordinary day for you. While you may not have totally understood what was going on at the moment, that special something became a benchmark in your life. After you were married, your perseverance to seek out that same truth you experienced then is what led you and your husband to that sure fountain of truth. What happened so many years before is what would ultimately take you to Sister Florence Swinford's church in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. It was there that you each found what you had been looking for. You both would grow in the Lord and accept your call to the ministry, and in doing so, you blessed the world of Pentecost like no one could have ever imagined in that moment. In truth, it was your staying power that prevailed. It was your unrelenting nature to search for what you had felt and experienced that ultimately has affected the lives of countless thousands of people all around the world. We are deeply indebted to the lady that is so much like the North Star that navigators have had to guide them for centuries. You can look into the sky night after night and find her ever-present light. In truth, it isn't just the light that guides them safely that becomes valuable. Is the fact that they always know where to look to find it. It so accurately describes a lovely lady that we are honoring tonight. You are that constant in an ever-changing world. Your steadfast nature has brought a great sense of hope to all that know you. Your quiet and unassuming nature isn't something that anyone should discount, because beneath that gentle exterior beats the heart of a true warrior of God. So on behalf of Jackie and I would like to simply say happy birthday and thank you. Reaching 75 is a major achievement, because the average lifespan in the United States is 78.6 years. But Jeff Arnold has never done anything average. So we may very well be back here in 25 years to celebrate his 100th birthday. When I think back to the day of his birth, September 2nd, 1944, I can't seem to remember anything. So I'll just have to start in 1978 when I met him. Back then, we both had thick, dark hair. His turned white, mine turned loose. At the time, he was preaching a revival for Reverend O.C. Crabtree in Panama City, and he had talked O.C., as he was affectionately known, into going to play golf that day. And I was with Alan, his son, and we met them on the first tee of the golf course. Jeffrey Wayne could hit a ball a long way, and he got up on the first tee and did just that. He cranked it out there. However, I guess another evangelist that had recently come through could also smack the ball. And every time Brother Arnold would hit a great shot, Brother Crabtree would say, "Terry could hit it further than that." And finally, Brother Arnold had enough, and he whirled around and
ever so politely laid his club on the ground and screamed, "I've heard enough about that scumbag." I was in awe, because this is the first time I'd ever met him, and I'd never heard a preacher use words like scumbag. I also remember that day they kept referring to somebody named Patty. And finally I asked, "Who is Patty?" And they said, "Well, that's Brother Arnold's wife." And so I just had to take their word for it, because it was 20 years later before I ever saw her for the first time. Not only was he good at golf, but he would continually amaze us with his sleight of hand. Come to think of it, that was the only time we ever played golf. And maybe that was because he kept making my clubs disappear. Some years passed, and we both came to Florida to pastor him, while he had mesmerized us with his sleight of hand. It was not long until he was awing and amazing us with his insight into the Word of God. On numerous occasions, my wife Corliss and I have driven to Gainesville just to have lunch with Brother Arnold, just so we could sit and listen to him expound on the Scripture. Because having lunch with him was like going to Bible study. Many Saturday nights, he would call me and he would be so hyper and so excited about his Sunday morning message. Not only did I have to listen, but I was expected to be just as hyper and just as excited as he was. And if I didn't respond the way he expected me to respond, he would just hang up. There was no goodbye. There was no see you later, just hang up. And I would tell my wife Corliss, "Well, I guess I won't hear from Jeff anymore, because I think he's mad at me for not being as excited as he was." A week later, I'm still trying to recover, and the phone rings, and it's him again with this Sunday's message, acting like nothing ever happened. And I finally figured it out. He knew that if I wasn't as excited about his message as he was, then I must be a loser. And he had warned me. He told me many times that he didn't hang out with losers. So it was my fault that he hung up on me. And now he was just giving me a second chance. Phone calls with Jeffrey have always been unique, to say the least. I've lost count of the times that Sister Gail has called me and told me that Brother Arnold likes me to call him. Knowing that he had just called me on Saturday, I'm wondering if he's had an accident, broken his fingers, that he's incapable of dialing, or, I mean, why else would he need Gail to call me to tell me to call him? And a greeting that I have heard from him on so many occasions that I can't even begin to count. I say hello. He says, "Hey, Mr. Superintendent Politician, don't forget I put you in office and I can take you out." Nothing like knowing you have accountability partner in your life, is it? Some people only see the brash, crusty Brooklynite, and I sometimes think that that's all he really wants us to see. However, I'd like to say that my friend Jeff Arnold has the heart the size of Texas.
Yes, sir.
And is the most giving, caring person that I have ever known. When my wife had cancer, long after the crisis was over, he was still calling every day. to just make sure she was okay and to remind us that he was still praying for her. And that's not just our story, you see. He has cared for and blessed more people through the years than you and I will ever be able to count. Brother Arnold, we're honored to help celebrate your 75th birthday. You've done so much for so many that only eternity will reveal your true worth in the kingdom of God. Happy 75th. We love you. They were evangelizing, living in Miramar, Florida. I was a 26-year-old first-time pastor. And he came often to Apopka, did Brother Arnold, Jeff, my friend. When not on the road, he came for fellowship, he came to preach. Ours is a friendship spanning more than 40 years, and for not a few reasons, a cherished treasure of Debbie and my life. To be sure, that early casual friendship morphed, but it only deepened with time and experience. It was anchored by our shared love for the Word of God, the unending quest among us to find ways to communicate it more efficiently and effectively. We were eager, spoiling to experience, to know, to see what God might do for us. In various seasons of life, not infrequently, Brother Arnold would come and enthrall our people with his magic. He would have them rolling in the aisles on Saturday night, but there was a method to the madness, because on Sunday he would have them on their faces or on their feet in the aisles on Sunday worshiping. Different times we have traveled the country and sometimes the world together. One time on our way to Asia, he somehow managed to be in a wheelchair that I had to push through airports on both sides of the sea. In the early days, we even shared a room several times. I'll leave that at saying it's a memory best forgotten. Preaching together, praying together, hearts on fire, passionate about God and his people. We've laughed, we've cried, we've agonized, we've celebrated. Like everybody else in this room tonight, we have traversed the whole of the human experience. Times of pleasure and times of pain, sharing joys and sorrows, some of our hopes realized, others lost. But always friends, that confidence and trust has not just survived, but has thrived through it all. As mercurial, as biblically brilliant, as funny, as larger than life as Brother Arnold was and remains, his truly better half, Sister Patty, was equally thoughtful, steady, measured, capable, strong. And when you take the sum of both Brother and Sister Arnold's significant accomplishments, what they have done together, I think the man and the minister who more often than not was out front would be quick to tell you that there was an extraordinary wife, mother, authentic Christian, and
first lady in the wings, keeping everyone and everything focused and centered. Behind the signature bold, brassy, conversational tones, he's hung up on me too. He spent the night in my house and left the next morning without saying bye. Welcome to our world. But besides the brassy, bold conversations and the side-splitting stories and the steel trap memory of people, places, and things that most of us would have forgotten, behind all of that beats one of the biggest and softest and most generous hearts that I ever encountered in near 50 years of ministry. Truth be told, we will not know on earth in time the people, the churches, the ministers, the missionaries that have our needs and causes, to whom and to which Brother and Sister Arnold have opened not just their hearts, but their hands, their pocketbooks. Amen. Helping someone get over an obstacle, through some storm, out of an untenable circumstance or situation. I certainly could not know all, but I know not a few have been the beneficiaries of his and Patty's benevolent hearts and hands, and I am one of them. You surely won't be surprised when I say it, I hope. I've wanted to choke him by times. To wring his neck at others. But when my spirit needed lifting, when I needed a reason to smile, or maybe even to laugh out loud, when I needed to hear an empathetic voice on the other end of the line to know someone would not just say they would pray, but would actually pray, I knew I could call Jeffrey. I found that in him, and it's there still. Whether something simple or serious, whether it was solving a penny problem or standing over my grandbaby's grave, I've been protected by those prayers more times than I can tell you. To his eternal credit, your pastor, Brother Jim Tony, has lauded the legacy of these lives well lived. This great church family, a bastion of truth, strong spiritually, strong numerically, strong financially. To his credit, your pastor has done nothing but sing Brother and Sister Arnold's praises everywhere.
Amen. All right.
A church not only strong in faith, but strong in a future. Because legacies don't last unless you have capable hands into which you can put them.
Amen.
Brother and Sister Arnold, you have inspired us. You have edified us. You have challenged us. You have helped equip us, both the man and ministry, capable companion, have blessed untold thousands here and abroad. And I'm confident, I'm very confident, this church family knows that you have been blessed to have been led by perhaps a one in a generation preacher, a lover of people and of God. And I'm extremely honored to say, my friend.
Amen.
May God bless you.
remain standing. Would you join with me and let's sing Happy Birthday? Can we do that?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Don't we love Brother Arnold? Don't we love Sister Arnold? Brother Arnold, we just wanted to take this time tonight to wish you a happy birthday. Tell you how much we love you.
I'm the only thing between you and feeding your face. Thank you for the wonderful remarks, Phil, Mother Montgomery, Cassie, for this great crew. Wish I knew the guy you talked about. Sounds fantastic. Been a blessed man. I thought about what Brother Boy had to say about my sweetie pie. And I don't know whether I ever told you this, but years ago, I almost lost her when we were evangelizing and lost our first baby. And she was in very bad shape. And we had to take her to the hospital, see if we could get her life saved. Did surgery on her, and then I went to see the prophet, T.W. Barnes. Now, you may not believe in prophets, I do. And he spoke to us. He scared the fire out of Patty because he had them little black beady eyes that look right through you. And he spoke to me. And in those days, I wasn't ever asked to be a preacher. I was a magician. I was a puppeteer. I was a lunatic. I did bus ministry. I did children's ministry. People hardly ever asked me to preach. And he turned around and looked at me, never forgot. He said, the Lord's going to raise you up. And he's going to make you a mighty preacher in this movement. And he's going to give you a revelation. I'm trying to figure out who he's talking to, because I don't get to preach for nobody. And he says, and you, all these little magic tricks and stuff you do, you're going to teach other people how to do that. You're going to put that away. And God is going to catapult you into a place, take you around the world. And I looked at him, and he turned around to Sister Arnold, and he said, girl. Now, when you talk with Brother Barnes, he said, girl, he looked at Sister Arnold, and he said, girl, he said, you're going to have to learn to live lonely, because God is going to take your husband everywhere, and you're going to have to stay faithful and pray for him and stay at home and share with the movement. And so with all the wonderful things that's been said tonight, thank you, Patty.
All right.
Thank you for sharing with me all the years and all the airplanes I've gone on and all the conferences we've been to together. Not one time has there been a voice of protest and mad and angry about me having to travel and go do this and do that. And so, he that findeth a wife, the Bible said, findeth a good thing.
Amen.
Thank you, thing. I love you. I thank you for allowing me to be a part of this. I've been going down memory lane these last few days and remembering Brother and Sister McGraw and Sister Elwood and Ruby Hadsock and folks that were a part of our handful in the old church, and how this church seemed to have nowhere to go but up. And the Lord blessed us and gave us favor. And you stood with me when I was not a very good pastor, and I didn't know how to pastor, and I just tried. And you were so patient to me, and you were so patient to my wife. And you loved my daughter. And for the Watsons, who were her Sunday school teachers, and they just were so kind. So I'm a debtor. I'm a debtor to grace. I'm a debtor to mercy. I'm a debtor to the long suffering of God. And I'm a debtor to the love of God's people. And I do love you. And I think that we're on the right track, and we got the right guy, and we're going in the right direction.
All right.
God bless you. You're dismissed. Join us in the back for some fellowship.